Hi there, I'm Nora, developer advocate for AI. I'm really excited to show you the generative AI hub today on SAP AI Core and its functionalities. There are a couple of different models that are available already and you can just compare the results, which I think is really cool. And I'm also going to show you some examples like text summarization, translation, product descriptions. And I mean, you can do all kinds of other things with large language models, like writing blog posts, having it grammar and spell check your things, giving feedback on a text or asking it to change the tone of a text for a different audience, doing sentiment analysis, writing code, doing math or extracting infos and parameters from a document and having it return it, for example, in a JSON file. There's a really cool tutorial that I'm going to link in the description from my colleague Drup Paul that you can also click through and just try it out yourself. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the important topic of prompt engineering and give you some examples and tell you about few-shot and zero-shot prompting. Because the quality of the response of a large language model really heavily relies on how you prompt it. Let's get started. So here we are in my SAP B2P cockpit. And as you can see, I have an instance of AI Core with the extended plan, which is important if you want to use the generative AI hub. And I have a subscription to the SAP AI Launchpad. So let's just open that. And here you can already see that I already connected my AI Core instance. Otherwise, you can just upload your service key here and add a new connection. And the service key you get from the service binding here. This is your service key. You can just download it and then upload it in your SAP AI Launchpad because you have to connect an AI Core instance to it. Yeah, and then we just pick a resource group. I'm just going to pick default. And here you can already see the Generative AI Hub tab. And here you see the ML operations tab, and we are going to start here. And the cool thing is you already have the scenario for the large language models here, so or foundation models. Just a quick info. Large language models are foundation models. The reason why we call it foundation models is that when large language models occurred, like GPT-3 and stuff, and people realize large language models are actually capable of doing a variety of tasks, like all the things I already said, like generate long texts, giving feedback on a text, writing descriptions, doing math, like simple math, and all kinds of things. So that's why Stanford University introduced this new term, foundation models, this foundational knowledge in this model that can do a variety of tasks and can be like fine-tuned to do different tasks and stuff. Okay, so these two scenarios I created. And this one you will find in your account. This one you will find in your account already because it's pre-configured from SAP. Yeah, so let's have a look what's available here. You have two executables for now. There will be more to come. But for now we have the Azure OpenAI models, which are the models GPT 3.5 Turbo, GPT-4, and the text embedding model. What is text embedding? When you want to teach any machine learning model about language, you basically have to tell the model, you have to give the model numbers because it can't really work with a word. So what you do is you have this vector space and every token, for simplicity, let's say a token is a word, and every word has a vector in that space. And that's basically how machine learning models look at words in language with this vector representation. So if you, for example, want to compare the similarity of two words or two documents, you can also get the text embedding of this word here. And then you get like an amount of numbers, like a big vector. And then you can compare how close those vectors are together. So how similar those documents are. Yeah. And then we also have the AI Core open source executable, and here for now we have the Falcon model, which is an open source large language model. Okay, what do you have to do when you want to use it? You have to create a deployment. How do you do that? By first creating a configuration. So we will create a configuration, we will give it a name. Let's just call it GPT 3.5. We pick our scenario, the foundation model scenario, and a version and an executable. So I call it GPT 3.5, so I should probably use the GPT models. Yeah, I'm going to use that one. And la 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 la, create this configuration. Now, with this configuration, you can now create a deployment. So let's create the deployment. And yeah, now it's going to take some time to update the information here and to turn the current status into the target status, which is obviously running. And then you will get a URL here that you can use to query the model. So let's look at another deployment. I already deployed a GPT-4 model. And here we have a URL. And this URL you can use really to just query the model in, for example, Postman or just any REST call from anywhere. You can just use this link and query it with a token, obviously. Or what you can do is go to the Generative AI Hub and use the prompt editor. Now, when you're using this for the first time, you will probably not see the administration tab because this is where you can like delete prompts from a certain user. But if you haven't prompted anything, you can't see it. So don't worry about it. It will occur once you prompted stuff. And here you have the prompt editor. If you don't see anything here, like if this is empty, that basically means that your deployment isn't ready yet or that you haven't created a deployment at all, then just go back to deployments and see if your status is running. We already have the GPT-4 model here, yeah. So we have to wait a little bit for the other model to occur, but that gives us time to just check out the prompt editor. So what do we see here? You can give a name to your prompt, a version, obviously, but this is also updated automatically. And a collection name, like for example, I don't know, translations, product descriptions, math, whatever. We're going to look at some that I created earlier already in a bit. Once you created a prompt, here's your message. So here you can like write, I don't know, let's just try something like good morning. And then we can just run it. Good morning, how can I assist you today? How polite. Then you can just save the prompt, for example. Or you can create a new one, or you can select one of the old prompts that you saved before. Yeah, so here you can select your models and you have some parameters that you can adjust. The frequency penalty, basically the higher the value here, the more it penalizes frequency of a token. You know how earlier I said that for simplicity, let's assume a token is a word. Tokens can be anything. It can be one character long. It can be like around 4 characters long. It can be like word stems. There are different tokenizers and the length depends on like the type of tokenizer that you use. You can also assume one word is a token. But in the GPT models, on average, one token is like around 4 characters long. Then you have the max tokens parameter where you can set the maximum amount of tokens used in this prompt interaction. So like response and prompt. And you have the presence penalty. The higher this value is, the more it penalizes tokens that are already present. And this will kind of make the model and the higher this value is, the more it will lead the model to talk about new topics and not so much about old topics in comparison to the frequency penalty where it just lets the model use different wording. So it doesn't just repeat the wording over and over because that would kind of make it sound like very robotic. And then you have the temperature one. This also is what makes the model a little bit more creative. So the higher the temperature, the more creative the model is allowed to be. Basically, what a large language model does is to calculate the next token, the probability of the next token that should follow in a certain sequence. And when the temperature is really low, it's just going to pick it's not going to look at so many of the top results that it has. It's just going to stick to the ones with the highest probability. And the higher you set the temperature, the more creative it can get. And then it also, it just makes it sound more human-like and not so accurate and not going to repeat itself so much. Okay. And then down here, you can also set tags or write notes for your prompt. Now we already talked about all the different things you can do with large language models, and I created some prompts beforehand already. So for example, here I have a translation example. Here you can then see the prompt that you wrote. Please translate the following sentence to German. This is a video on the Generative AI Hub in SAP AI Core. And then it translates that to German. Dies ist ein Video über den generativen AI Hub in SAP AI Core. And here you see the model versions, for example, and you can also open this in the prompt editor now and run it again. Yeah, this is going to translate it again. And then we can also select others that we created. For example, we can create product descriptions. Um, create a description for a product page of SAP AI Launchpad in 50 words, and then it created this response for me. SAP AI Launchpad is an end-to-end platform for managing, deploying, and monitoring artificial intelligence models, la 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 la. Yeah, so there are basically two main types of writing prompts. There's few-shot and zero-shot prompting. And with zero-shot prompting, what you essentially do is that you write one prompt by giving very detailed instructions. So you can, for example, assign a role. You can say, you are a developer advocate, or you are a service assistant, or you are Stephen Hawking, or you are whatever you want the model to be or behave like. And you can set a tone. You can say, for example, be very polite, or adjust the tone to fit for the developer audience, or I don't know, be funny or sound like a pirate or whatever. And then you can also give, for example, like a step-by-step guide. So you say like, first do this, then do this, or I don't know. For example, as a service assistant, Drup gave this example of saying, first do a sentiment analysis. And if the message that you got from the user is negative, then apologize. If it's positive, then say thank you or something like that. You can give like if scenarios, you can give a step-by-step guide. I also have one math example here in a bit that I'm going to show you how you can help GPT to like respond better. Then there is few-shot prompting. And few-shot prompting basically relies on the fact that the model understands relationships. And for example, in this example, I'm also using few-shot prompting because I start with a title. Title is SAP AI Launchpad. And then I use the description that it just created for me before, the product description that I asked it to create. And then I say the title of the next product is SAP AI Core, and the description is, and then it gives me the description for the product SAP AI Core. Or something that is, I think, a very famous result, at least in natural language processing, you see it all the time. So each word or token has like this vector in the vector space, right? And there's the vector for woman and there's the vector for queen. And the relationship between the vectors woman and queen is the same or very similar to the relationship between the vectors man and king. So if you hear, for example, say to the model, woman to queen is the same as man to, it will return king. And you can, for example, do the same thing with like, let's do it like this. Germany to Berlin is the same thing as France to, and then it should obviously give me Paris, and it does. So this is basically how large language models, by having so much data and having like read so many things, they kind of get an understanding of the relationship between words. And this is why they also give us the feeling to have like an understanding of the world, you know? Okay, now the last example that I wanted to show you is actually a funny example because it is a math example. And let's have a look at it here, because then you see why I find it funny. So I have different versions here. And because the first time I found this math example on the OpenAI website, in the documentation. And they say that when they ask this simple math question, the answer should be 12. And GPT basically calculates it up to a point correctly and then does something weird and then comes up with the answer 17, which is wrong. So I wanted to try it out, and when I tried it out the first time, it actually did it right. Like, here's what I asked it. So the same, I just copy-pasted the math question. And the response was actually correct. It gave me 12. So I was like, hey, it does know. And then when I wanted to shoot the video, I tried it again, and then it didn't work. That was this version here. It gave me a completely random... this version here. Gave me a completely random answer, like 8, also random logic. So what can I do if I get a result like this? The problem is, when you read it and you don't know math so well, this response actually seems like it could be right. So 7 times 6 is 42, which is correct. So it kind of like, it could make sense, you know, it's not too far-fetched. This result actually sounds fine. So if you are not so good at math, you could just believe it. And this is what's called a hallucination of the large language model. And the problem with hallucinations is that large language models almost always give you a response to what you ask it. And if they don't give you a response, like if they say something like, I don't know, then they were taught to say, I don't know. Because technically what a large language model does is just calculate the probability of the next token and then just create a text with that. So they always have an answer. And the answer almost always sounds grammatically correct. even if the facts underneath are wrong. So in this case, it made up facts, which is obviously wrong, but it doesn't sound like it. And that's kind of the danger with hallucinations and with large language models. And that's why you cannot just use them for any use case. And if you have a use case where your large language model like responds with a lot of hallucinations and you know the topic and you realize there are different ways of how to handle it. One is called retrieval augmented generation, where you basically give the model context information to use before it responds. So you give it like a number of documents to look through before it responds. But you can also do that in the prompt directly. For example, you could also just paste some context information and say, use this context to respond, for example. And then you can be sure that the model doesn't just make up facts. Yeah, but as I already said, prompting is very, very important. And the quality of the result really heavily relies on your prompt. And that's why, for example, here, I changed the prompt a little bit. And I said the same question first. And then what I did was first calculate the product of the last two digits of both numbers, and then summarize the unit digit and the tens digit of the result from step one. And this way, it always came up with the correct response, because now it just does exactly what I tell it to do. Let's open this in the prompt editor and have a look. Okay, so here we see the prompt that I changed by adding the steps. We see the response that the GPT-4 model gave. And now let's compare it to the GPT-3.5 model that we deployed. It's here. And now we can just run the same prompt and see if it can also give the correct response. It cannot, actually. So now you might ask, why would you want to compare GPT models anyway if you could just use the GPT-4 model always? Because that's like the biggest model, so that usually leads to the best result. But the thing is, the GPT-4 model is also slower than the GPT-3.5 Turbo model, and it's also more expensive to query like the biggest model than, for example, to query a smaller GPT model or even the open source Falcon model. That's why it's always good to check a use case with GPT-4, see whether your use case works at all, and if you get it working with GPT-4, then try to downgrade it by, like, for example, using a smaller model that you fine-tuned, or just checking if it works with a smaller model out of the box, because then you can save cost and time. Okay, so this doesn't work, but just to show you that it does work with GPT-4, we are going to run it again with GPT-4. Yeah, so for this particular use case, we cannot downgrade yet, but maybe with a model that you would train a little bit more on math examples, for example, like fine-tune it on math, you could downgrade. Let's have a look at another one. Maybe, for example, translation works well with GPT-3.5. Let's try out that. So we again change the model down here, and we see if that works. Dies ist ein Video zum generativen KI-Hub in SAP AI Core C. It even translated the AI to KI for künstliche Intelligenz in German. Cool. Yeah, so in this tech bite, you should have learned how you can use the generative AI Hub on SAP AI Core. You should have seen multiple different examples of how large language models can help you in your work. And you should have understood the importance of prompting. And yeah, just if you want to try it out, as I already said, I linked the really good tutorial of my colleague Drupal in the description. And just go and try it out. It's really not so difficult. Just go and try it out. And one more thing I want to say in the end is that with prompting, it really sometimes also just depends on wording, like just adding a please or changing, I don't know, like the word describe to explain or something. Already makes a big difference with the results. So just try out different prompts, try to be as specific as possible, give examples if you can, and yeah, let me know if there's anything else you want to know about prompting in the comments, and I hope you enjoyed the video.